It's not working. Okay, good. Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Betül Durak from Rutgers University. In this talk, I will be presenting our joint work with Thomas DuBuisson from Galois Incorporation and David Cash from Rutgers University. It's titled as What Else is Revealed by Order Revealing Encryption. So let's start with order preserving encryption, which is introduced in Boldirova et al. In 2009. An OP scheme is an encryption scheme in which the ciphertexts preserve the ordering of underlying messages. So it's defined as strictly increasing function. So it allows, given any pair of ciphertexts, we can apply standard comparison operation on these two ciphertexts, and we can determine the underlying, the ordering relation of underlying messages without seeing them. Okay. We also have order revealing encryption, which is a generalized form of order preserving encryption with some distinctions, but these distinctions are not too important for this talk, so I'll skip them, and I will only refer to ORE for the rest of this talk. So let's look at how ORE is used in practice. We have a database table with some columns, multiple columns, and we apply ORE on each columns individually under different keys. Okay. And then we okay. I'm sorry for the. Okay. I have some problem with the clicker. Do you? Okay, so we apply ORE on each columns individually, and we obtain the encrypted table. So ORE is motivated to do range queries on encrypted databases, and the sorting or threshold filtering as well. And here we see an example of a range query on both plain text column and encrypted column. Okay, simple enough to query on encrypted column, we encrypt our bounds in our range, the upper and lower bounds, and we give it to the server, and database returns as the results between these two encrypted values. Okay, so the server is we don't modify any software on the server. So the server is a normal service, like Salesforce. Therefore, ORE is very easy to use and very fast to use in order to execute range queries. And there are some companies who use ORE. Some are deploying it, like Sky High Networks or CypherCloud. Some are just prototyping them, like Google or Microsoft. And we have some academics that use ORE, perhaps most famously known as CryptDB. Right. Okay. So let's overview our results. So in this talk, we have two parts I will be talking about. In the first part, I will give some attacks on ORE with correlated columns. So we have a single encrypted column. The adversary captures the single column, and it runs attacks on this. This is what people have been thinking so far. Okay. However, the adversary is free to pick multiple columns. So the adversary captures the entire table, and it can run attack on this table with multiple columns together, okay? So now this adversary has more power than the adversary who attacks on a single column. So briefly, I will be giving the first work, we give the first work to attack the correlated columns, and we show that there exist possible attacks on multiple columns even when the individual columns are highly secure and impossible to attack. Okay, this will be the first part. And in the second part, I will give some attacks on ORE with non-uniform data. More precisely, we will give the first analysis of practical ORE when data are not uniform. So in the security theorems and the proofs, give some intuitions about the implications of security, but they use proofs when the input data is uniformly at random. Of course, the data is not random in practice. So we want to look at how it looks, how the security implications show the security in non-random data. And we will be looking at some specific instantiations of ORE. I will talk about them when we go. And we will see that some practical ORE constructions reveal far more information than it's supposed to reveal with random data. Okay. So we will compare various instantiations of ORE. and we will see how much they, how much more they reveal together. And in this work, we have attacks run on geolocation data and time using some timestamps. Okay. And as a high-level conclusion, we would like to say that so current theorem and the definitions do not apply on real data. And perhaps some encrypted database applications are less secure than it's previously thought. So we should be watching ourselves. And maybe the current systems should consider correlated column relation when they encrypt their database and when they want to evaluate the security with the current systems. Okay. So let's start with background and ORE. There are some security issues with ORE. So an ORE, by the definition of the primitive, makes the security fundamentally weaker than standard encryption. Okay. So a passive adversary who only captures the ciphertext learns some information about the plaintext, the encrypted plaintexts already. And moreover, if we give chosen plaintext power to that adversary, the ORE is totally broken. Okay. And this, and furthermore, security is analyzed in Boldero et al. In 2009. And since then, the research approach is to construct ORE schemes with the best possible security notions to develop practical systems, secure and practical systems. As we have seen in this line of work, starting from Agrawal 2004, on this line of research. Okay. So we have two classes of ORE that we would like to classify. In the first one, so let's say we have an encrypted column. So this is a meaningless hexadecimal strings. This column includes meaningless strings. And seeing this column, the adversary learns only the ordering of messages by seeing these meaningless strings. Okay. And we call this ORE as ideal ORE if it only reveals the ordering relation of messages and nothing more than that. No information about the plain text. This can be achieved in dynamic data. This can be achieved with indistinguishability obfuscation and multilinear maps. But those are heavily mathematical tools and they are not practical. And we have some interactive protocols. As we have seen, they allow the interaction between the key holder and server. And on the other hand, we have leaky ORE constructions that leaks the ordering of plain text plus some information, more extra information about the plain texts. For example, in this specific example, we reveal the first two digits of the plain texts when we encrypt it, okay, for each row, and the rest of it is looks random. So we have these constructions, and these constructions are fast and block cipher-based constructions. And this extra information includes some plain text bits, some statistical information, and perhaps more. Okay. And one way is proofs given when the input data is random for these works. Okay. So let's look at the prior attacks on ORE, starting from Navid et al. Last year. And in their work, they were able to recover the plaintext from ideal ORE in two cases. In the first case, when the entire message space is encrypted. Okay. I'm sorry, but this is not working at all. So can someone fix this? This is not working, the clicker.
It's a little bit flaky, yeah. It's been very flaky. Where's the... Ah, okay, you have to point it. You have to point it back. You have to point it.
Maybe I should stay right there. Okay. It's okay. I think we need to change the battery. Can we do it? I'm sorry for the interruption. Okay.
Yeah, you like really have to
Okay. So yeah, prior attacks on ORE, starting from Navid et al. In 2015, they are able to recover the plaintext from ideal ORE in two cases. In the first case, when we encrypt the entire domain, what we can do is that the adversary can obtain all the ciphertexts, and it sorts the ciphertext and it maps the ciphertext to the messages. So in this attack, this attack is simple but and a very effective attack. And they apply it on real data, encrypted medical records, and specifically the columns, admission months and mortality risks columns. Okay. And the admission months column, 12, the message size is, the domain size is 12, and the mortality risks, the domain size is 6. As you see, it's a very small domain. Okay. In the second case, we have, when we repeat the plain texts a lot, it allows us to do frequency analysis. And the attack works with two vectors. One is an auxiliary data on which the plaintext data are drawn. And the second one, and their frequencies. And we have ciphertext information with a lot of repeating rows. And it has frequency information as well. And what all attack does is to map between ciphertext to the plaintext based on the minimizing the error in between the frequencies between ciphertext and the plaintext. Okay. And this specific attack is applied to, again, medical records, encrypted medical records, like age column or length of stay column. Okay. So it has some limitations. When we don't have dense data, when we don't encrypt the entire database message space, then this attack doesn't work. First attack, sort attack doesn't work. And when we never repeat, we never allow frequency analysis, the second attack doesn't work either. So in these two cases, we have some limitations. And we would like to see how it works when we don't have these two cases. So let's start with first part, which is the correlated column in ORE, and see how effective attacks we can have with this. So in this two tables, on the upper one, we have the encrypted database, ORE encrypted database. In the bottom, we see the leaked information about these in ideal case. So we only leak the ordering of messages. So if you look at the individual column, first name, for example, over here, we see just the ordering of the names. But if you look together with the first name and last name, we see we have some correlation, and we see that this column is this column includes the second biggest first name and second biggest last name. Okay. So I want to start with an artificial example, okay, to have some fun first. In this example, we have a funny penguin sitting in the two-dimensional grid, and we can depict this penguin with 1 million points, and all the points are between 0 to 2,000. And that means that, and I want to pick a small subset of this, and I want to pick 300 plain texts, okay? And the database, my database looks like this. Yeah, it has to change, like somewhere.
Just go ahead, have a few more now. Go ahead and don't do it incrementally.
Okay, just that I skipped already one of the slides that is not visible here. It appears and disappears. Okay, much better. Thank you. So we have 300 plain texts, and when we look at this plain text, it looks like this. We have an X column and Y column, and we have 300 rows and all entries from 0 to 2000. Okay. We encrypt it, and we obtain this ciphertext. We encrypt it with ideal ORE. We obtain this ciphertext, which reveals only the ordering of these messages. And now the ideal leakage only gives me some values, which is from 0 to 300. Okay. So the Navid et al. Attack doesn't apply, because I didn't encrypt the entire database. It's just a small subset. The data is not the encrypted data is not dense, and we avoided repeating the X column or Y column. So no repetition is allowed. So frequency analysis is trivial for this case. Okay. So if you insist to apply Navid et al. Attack, this is what you will obtain with X axis. Okay. Or this is what you will obtain with Y axis. But the idea is to use both together and correlated these two correlated X and Y columns and plot it like this. So now, by seeing only the ideal leakage, the ordering relation of ciphertext, we see this a little bit fatty penguin in the ideal with the ideal leakage versus the plain texts. Okay, this is what we want to apply on real data sets, and our real data sets include some geolocation data and timestamps. We have some California road intersections consist of 21,000 latitude longitude points. And we encode them in 27 bits. We also have some location, geolocation data from German politician bits. It has 1,500 unique latitude longitude points collected over 6 months. And it's publicly available. And we encoded the 32 bits due to the higher precision. And we, in paper, we also use timestamps, but in this talk, I won't mention them. So now let's visualize this two-dimensional attack on real data sets. On the left, we see we have 21,000 data in our database, and we only picked 2,000 of them. And we took this 2,000 and we plot it on the map, and the plain text look like on the left. Okay, and we apply ideal ORE. We obtain the leakage from ideal ORE, which is the ordering, and we plot it on two-dimensional grid, which is on the left, which is on the right. And by looking at the ideal leakage, we can obtain this shape, which is very similar to the plain text, even with fine-grained details, like the curves of LA and some outliers over here, okay? So, but this data is on a two-dimensional grid now. So we didn't obtain anything about the plain texts. If you would like to guess some plain texts, we can give some power to the adversary. The adversary can obtain some bounding box of California, which is the minimum and maximum points, latitude and longitude points of California. And it can generate some latitude, longitude points inside this bounding box proportional to the XY points in the right, okay? And when we do that, we can guess 30% of points in our 2000 encrypted data within 50 kilometers, okay? So this is not too dangerous maybe, but quantitatively, but qualitatively it's very dangerous, I mean. We will see it with mobile history and mobile location data as well. So in this data set, we picked the subset of data because we have timestamps. We wanted to look at specific day, a week, and a month. Okay. So we picked these subsets, and we joined the consecutive points to plot them on the map. So this data, so Spitz data, he's traveling around Germany a lot. So this is for 1 day, 1 week, and one entire month. Okay. And we want to see how it looks like when we encrypt these points with ideal ORE, what the ideal leakage would look like. So we computed the leakage on entire database instead of just a subset of this. And we took the same subset from computed ideal leakage on this data set. And we did the same, like we joined the consecutive points to plot them on two-dimensional grid now, okay? So we did the same for, again, 1 day, 1 week, and one entire month. If you want to see the similarities, I have these similarities shown here. Okay, on the upper one, we have the plain text data joined consecutive points. On the bottom, we see the ideal leakage on two-dimensional grid. Again, this is not a quantitative work. We didn't didn't guess any plain text or anything. But if adversary knows this guy sits, lives in Germany and giving some information about the bounding box of Germany and playing with it, applying some data mining techniques, we can get pretty good information about about his travel information, private information. Okay. So what we have learned from this part is we don't suggest to use geolocation data with ORE. So it appears to be dangerous to use it with ORE. And maybe the encrypted database applications are overlooking the dangerous side of correlated column relation. So maybe we should be more careful about encrypting our data with ORE when we have correlation between columns. Okay. So we have some open questions, of course. We didn't analyze the security loss for the correlated columns in this work. It's an interesting, it could be an interesting future work. And we didn't apply it for other data sets, like first names or last names, due to the time constraint. And we don't know what other type of data, realistic data, we can use to analyze with correlated column relation and give more recommendations to the practitioners. Okay. So having said this, now we can switch from, so we have seen some correlated column relation with ideal ORE, and now we can look at some specific instantiations of ORE, which leaks little more than just ordering. Okay. We want to analyze them with non-uniform data. So we will take two important constructions. The first one is going to be the Boldireva et al. Construction that gives the first practical ORE construction. It's fast and block cipher-based construction. And the security implies that it leaks half of the plain text bits, most significant part of the plain text bits, okay? So in the second construction we will look at is the Chenat et al. Construction, which gives another practical construction, but it targets, it has a different security flavor. So we want to look at it as well, and it leaks considerably fewer bits than Boldireva et al. Construction, okay? There are some subsequent works, as we have seen here, but we won't talk about them in this talk. Okay, and the third construction that we'll be looking at is going to be the double encryption of Boldireva et al. And Chenat et al. Construction. So I will talk about them as well. But let's look at let's start with Boldireva et al. Construction. In the paper, so they define a security notion called ROPF, stands for Random Order Preserving Encryption, and it states that ROPF secure ORE construction should be indistinguishable from a random strictly increasing function, okay? So imagine that we have a domain from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1, and we have a range from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1 when n is bigger than m. So this how a random, how a strictly increasing function should look like. So more precisely, when we will preserve the ordering relation of messages on ciphertexts, okay? And when we pick this ROPF secure ORE should be indistinguishable from this random, this specific strictly increasing function. We shouldn't be distinguish which one is ORE or which one is strictly increasing function. Okay. So following up this work, Boldireva et al. In 2011 show some attacks on their construction. And in their attack, specifically, what they have done is that given a random X, random input X, we encrypt it, and they provide a practical attack to guess an X prime, the value X prime, with this bound, given this bound. So they were able to guess the actual plain text X within the, with this bound. Okay, don't worry about what that means, I will get to that in a minute. And our messages are from, again, from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1. And they, furthermore, they showed that no efficient attack can output X prime more accurate than this, much closer than this. Okay, this is an important proof. And they proof uses a lot of, they borrow a lot of tools from probability theory and et cetera. And if we want to look at what intuitively this bound says, we can consider this message X as an m-bit message. And this bound is telling that if I have an m-bit message over here, I reveal the first half of the message for message bits, and the most significant half of the message bits. So this is the least significant part, this is the most significant part. And the bound says that we reveal this half of it, and the only hiding the least significant half of it, okay? And we want to see how it performs in real data. That's why we wanted to see some non-uniform data set, and we picked from 2 to the 0 to 2 to the m minus 1, okay? And we run the same attack, same prior attack on this specific data set, okay? And we want to see how well the attack performs with this data. So what we have done is that we set the message length at 64 bits, and the ciphertext size at 128 bits. And we want to measure how far away the guess that we can come up with this attack is away from the actual message, okay? So in this specific plot, what this says is that, for example, for the data 2 to the 4, so this is a long log scale, okay? For the message 2 to the 40, we were able to guess the message within 2 to the 19 or to the 20, okay? Or for message 2 to the 32, we can able to guess the message within 2 to the 44. What that means is that, so this line shows the predicted the predicted accuracy, okay? It should have been only in this bound. It should have been accurate with this bound. But what we can see here is that the message 2 to the I is predicted with, within 2 to the I over 2, which is more accurate than what the theory results tells us. Okay. So this is an important point in practice, because we more likely to use those type of messages than random data in practice. Okay. And interestingly, when we encrypt the zero, we always reveal a zero, 100% accuracy. Okay. And we more likely to use encrypted zero or one or small messages, small domains in practice. So that's why it's an important observation that we don't want to miss. So we can conjecture this. So in the, unlike the previous intuition that says it reveals the half of the bits, for small domains or large domains, all of the leading zero bits or one bits plus the half of the most significant bits for the remaining bits will be revealed. I mean, we want to formalize and prove this as a future work. So, okay. So we have seen Boldrova et al. Construction on non-uniform data, okay, and we have seen how accurate we can get with the known attacks and give some security proofs on random data. And with non-random data, with real data, we can get more accurate results. Okay. So now we want to look at the Chenat et al. Construction, which is slightly different flavor, so security notion. So for this construction, we have assume we have three plaintexts. Okay, for any pair of plaintexts, the security tells that the security notion tells that it reveals the index of first bit when they differ, when they start differing. So for example, if you look at the first two pair, XI and XJ, the most significant differing bit is the third one, and the adversary is able to learn the third bit. Since it knows the ordering, it learns that XI is bigger than XJ, so XI should be 1, XJ should be 0. And it continues with XJ and XK. Okay, it realizes that the second bits are differing, and it reveals that second bit for XJ and XK. And the second bit of XI is also revealed because XI and XJ shares the same prefix. Okay, so we call this most significant differing bit leakage. So this is how the construction works. So as you see, when we get more data, more plain text encrypted with this construction, we keep continue leaking more bits. Okay. So the theorem says that the security notion says that it leaks asymptotically less bits than Boldrova et al. Construction. Okay. And we would like to compare this Boldrova et al. Construction, Chenat et al. Construction, and the double encryption. So in the double encryption is suggested in the work Chenat et al. 2015 in order to secure the database furthermore with double encryption. That means that we can apply ORE on top of OPE in order to obtain another ORE construction, and the security is at least as good as the underlying OPE encryption. Okay, this is what double encryption would help us. And in here, I would like to show you a CDF plot of our comparisons. So in this, for this plot, what we have looked at is for our OPF, what is the longest common prefix for each plain text? Okay, we picked 2,000 plain texts, and for each plain text, what is the longest common prefix for our OPF? And for MSDB, we computed all the leaked bits and we counted them, how many bits are leaked, okay? And for RDEN-M, which is a double encryption, first encrypted with Boldrova et al. And then Chenat et al. So we looked at the same way, how many bits are leaked in the first half of the ciphertext, So in here, we see that it's a CDF plot. We can read it as y percent of the plain texts are revealed, x percent or more bits. So when we get closer to the y-axis, the security gets better and better. And we get further from y-axis, the security starts getting worse. So CLWW construction, Chenat et al. Construction is better than Boldrava et al. Construction, but it's not dramatically better. And when we increase the data set size from 2,000 to 5,000, it gets almost same. Okay. So here is an example of Chenat et al. Construction with the leaked bits in, for our data set. So we applied, we simulated the leakage, Chenat et al. Leakage for latitude points for California data set. And this is what we can get. So all the X points are hidden bits. We don't know, they might be zero or one. And all the rest is known to the adversary because due to the leakage from the construction. Okay. And I would like to, we would like to visualize this because we like visualizing. And but with hidden bits, it was tough to do. It, the hidden bits would be either zero or one. So if it is one, it gets some value. If it is zero, it gets another value which is smaller than the other value. So instead of zero or one, we plot it with 0.5. So we took the average. Okay, so that's why we call it zero. So the bit 0.5 bit doesn't make sense, but yeah, it's the. So this is what we have obtained after this leakage with Chenat et al. Construction. We see this map of California over here with so many components. Perhaps by hands we can combine these components, but we would like to automate it. So we offer a guessing algorithm, which is simple enough. So for the guessing algorithm, for each unknown bits X or Y, we try to replace it based on minimizing the pairwise distance between the plain texts. Okay, simple enough. So we want to see how it performed, what is the accuracy. And we run the attack on data size from 25 to 2,000, but I won't show the entire results. You can go to our paper to see the further more results. And I only show the results from 2,000, data set size 2,000. So in here, we can see that, so this is the accuracy of attack in kilometers, okay? As we can see, we can get more than, this is 55.6 of plain text guessed within 0.5 kilometer, okay? And 100% of plain text are guessed within 5 kilometers with the guessing algorithm, okay? So what was the previous, without the guessing algorithm, the MSDB leakage explicitly revealing bits within 400 kilometers. So we were able to guess much better in this way. We apply the same, we apply the same results to the double encryption as well. And the results are on our paper again. I won't talk about it in this talk. And you can go to look at the results, which are similar. So it didn't get any better than single encryption, individual encryption. Okay. So what are the conclusions? So correlation. Correlation is important. Correlation causes some information leakage, even for ideal ORE cases. And we want to maybe be careful with real data in practice because the one-wayness or some other proofs are made when input data is random. And double encryption appears not helping too much for some data sets. Okay. And we are left with some open questions, again, to underline. We want to quantify the security loss for a correlation, and we want to look at some other data sets, more realistic data sets, that uses correlation to make more efficient attacks. And we conjectured something about the Boldrava et al. Construction. The theory suggests something, and we get more accurate attacks on real sets, and we want to look at that. So can we construct more better leakage, better ORE's with better leakage? So those are the questions I would like to answer. Thank you.
Clip show, we went a little bit over time, but we have maybe time for one or two questions. If there are no questions from the audience, I would like to ask one question. Could you go back to the slide with the graph for the Baldy Weber where you had
the Baldy, this one, the comparison?
No, I think one earlier.
This one, yes.
So I don't quite understand. So you take plain texts of size.
Plain text of size 64, and we encrypted the messages 2 to the 0, 2 to the 8, 2 to the 16. Those are the messages in the logarithmic form.
Ah, okay. So you encrypted only the smaller part.
Yes. And then this is the accuracy that we will get with the attack. So the difference between the our guess and the actual plain text, actual message, the difference between them. So the difference between them should be this, 2 but to the 32 for all the messages.
Okay, I have to look at it in detail, but did you assume that you knew that that part of the message space was encrypted?
That part of my... Yeah, sure. This is not the size. So he put them.
But this confuses me a little bit because it's really counter to the proof, right? Yeah. Okay. Let's thank Betül again.